Chattle!
A Star Wars podcast featuring myself, Darth David, the number one Sith in the galaxy, baby. The number one most entertaining Sith in the galaxy, according to Contrarian 420, a.k.a. Trev. More artwork from Contrarian / Trev that we will be displaying tonight. But with me, as always, because Darth David can't do this show by himself, you know why? Someone has to hit this speaker at the beginning of the show.
Someone has to be the punching bag.
Here he is, ladies and gentlemen, the most wonderful galactic punching bag in the universe, Jedi Jared!
Thank you very much, David. Thank you, Darth David, for that very wonderful yet passive-aggressive...
Yeah, very, very... Well, I have two tones with you. Passive-aggressive and aggressive-aggressive. That's what I like to do.
Yes, yeah, I'm aware.
Now, we have a big show, and it's the holiday season, mister. We are in December.
I know.
Huh?
I know.
That means Christmas lights for me, and some Hanukkah lights for you, and to all of our friends and neighbors out there, a happy holiday season.
Yes.
Okay, we're going to keep it like that.
Okay.
All right?
Yes. That's fine with me.
But for Star Wars fans across the globe, we want them to have an extra happy holiday season. Because Star Wars fans are the best. You know, I'm having some problems with some people at work lately. At my radio station, where I dominate the morning radio. 95.9 FM WRAT in New Jersey. And I'm here at the Jersey Shore, Monmouth and Ocean Counties. Listenership potential of 1.7 million people. And number one here at the Jersey Shore. Where's my round of applause, Meatball?
Well, I'm going to ask, do you really want to bring up any issues that you're having?
No, I do. Because it's got a lot to deal with Star Wars. I can't get anyone into watching Andor.
Really?
The people who watch Star Wars are like, I don't understand it. I don't know. What? Some of the people don't even remember Cassian Andor from Rogue One. Look, I am the most hardcore Star Wars fan at my radio station.
I'm sure.
By a mile. We have then a couple other good Star Wars fans, I would classify them, and then a ton of casual / I don't really know anything about Star Wars. The casual fans who even saw Rogue One. They saw the movie and they liked it. I go, well, are you watching Andor now? They go, no, what's that about? I go, you said you watched Rogue One and you liked it. They go, yeah, Rogue One's great. I go, Andor, it's the guy. They forgot his name. They remember the Cassian. They don't remember the Andor.
Do these folks have Disney Plus?
Yes, they have Disney Plus. What I'm saying is they're not watching the show when I'm trying to tell them about the show because they're not interested in Andor.
Oh, well.
And I'm like, but that's, you said you liked Rogue One. I don't get it. It's very contradictory to me. You know, I'll just watch anything Star Wars and enjoy it. But don't even get me started. It bleeds from the radio station. That's been a conversation that I've been having with people where I've been frustrated and yelling at my coworkers, calling them names, and generally just being a superior prick around the radio station, judging people for not watching Andor. I'm blunt, and I even had someone say to me, "Why do you have to be so obnoxious when questioning me about why I haven't seen Andor?" They actually said, "I know, okay, it's the holiday season, Dave. And I know I haven't gotten around to it. I do love Star Wars. But why do you have to be so obnoxious about it? Why are you yelling at me?" Sadly, you think I only talk to you like this. No, I talk to the whole damn radio station. If they upset me with Star Wars, I do. Siths are Siths 24/7, 365. I can't drop it. It ain't no act.
So, was this on air? Did you do this on air?
I've done it on air and off air. I'm yelling at the goddamn sales guy at the radio station.
At least you're doing it on air, so that makes for great radio.
I'm doing it everywhere I can. I'm pretty sure I'm going to get fired from my radio job. I've been there 9 years at WRAT 95.9 FM, have built a number one massive morning show, And, yeah, if I keep it up, I'm now being called obnoxious. Do you think I'm obnoxious? Is Darth David obnoxious? Jedi Jared, you are on the button with that comment, but I swear to God, Sith Stanley, I'm going to need you to hand me the red lightsaber.
I think it's endearing.
That's a good answer, brother.
I think it's endearing.
Yep.
Like, I know how to be obnoxious.
There you go. Thank you, pal.
Because of what I have to do for a living.
Mm-hmm. Be careful.
But my obnoxious is kind of like just, hey, it's a friendly reminder kind of obnoxious.
Mm-hmm.
I think the obnoxiousness is very endearing.
Okay.
You're like, oh, he's...
I'm waiting for you to say something that's going to irritate me.
I'm trying to cover you.
Well, I have the lightsaber in striking position for the people who are doing the podcast only, which is most of you.
Everyone loves it.
Some people might be watching this on YouTube, East Side Dave TV, if you want to see the video. We can't blame you for listening. This is a podcast, really. But I am getting the lightsaber in striking position because you're saying it's endearing, but you're not giving me any reasons why. And I feel like you're going to go into a negative place soon.
No, I'm not. I can't bring up anything that we used to talk about on
any of our car rides?
Well, not any of the car rides. No, the car rides were all super fun. But you told me I couldn't bring up anything from previous jobs.
You got to take 1 week off from a reference with Ron and Fez and Opie and Anthony.
So,
and the fact that I had to say that out loud.
I know, I am.
Oh, wait a second. We should mention Pat from Menaki.
Oh, yes. Rip.
Let's give Pat from Menaki. Okay, this is the one time I'll let you break your rule. We had this guy actually made TMZ.
Yeah, no, he was trending on Twitter.
TMZ. his name is Pat. Patrick Philbin. And he passed away, unfortunately. He was a huge part of the Opie and Anthony, Ron and Fez community. He was actually a competitive eater, a big-time competitive eater. He did get on to ESPN for some of those July 4th Nathan's hot dog eating contests. He made national TV, and he had some, like, record. It was the eggnog, because his most famous Opie and Anthony thing was he did an eggnog thing.
Baby bird.
He drank as much eggnog as humanly possible, and then there was an O&A intern who sat underneath him, and he threw up the
Pat
eggnog.
Duffy, yes.
And it was called baby birding, because the birds, you know, puke into each other's mouths or something.
Yes.
I don't know. I'm not a nature guy. But the point is this. The point is, Pat was a great guy, and he was a competitive eater, like I said. He was on O&A, and Ron and Fez was hysterical. He was the king of the one-liners. He always had a one-liner ready to go.
And
loved him.
His delivery was always like...
Sweet man, too.
Very like...
Gave me a ride in his van a couple times.
What, the O&A van?
Yeah, he gave me a ride in his van a couple times. Davey Mack needed a ride home. There's Pat Rubinaki from the Art Center, from... I don't know, a couple venues. I remember maybe from Lakewood, maybe where the Blue Claws played. Did O&A have an event there? I don't remember. But regardless, he was a really great guy, and he's going to be missed. So rest in peace, Pat from Menaki, Patrick Philbin.
Yeah,
rest anything in peace. Else to add?
Oh, no, Pat always had a, he always delivered his jokes with, like, no confidence, and then he would do that.
Oh, it was great. And every joke was hysterical, too.
Yeah.
Every single one.
He was a great, great contributor.
He was kind of like Sith humor.
Yes.
He was Sith humor without being evil, without being Palpatine.
But yes, Dave, when you...
So by the way, shout out. Rest in peace, Pat from Naki.
Rest
continue.
In peace, Pat.
And that's how we're going to do our your little O&A reference, Ron Fez reference for the week. Let's go.
I mean,
what were you going to say?
We're still
talking about me being obnoxious, right? How you find it endearing for somehow?
Yeah, I do.
How is that possible?
Well, because there are different kinds of obnoxiousness, and yours is like, I need to get the laugh out of them.
Oh, okay. Yeah, there's something to that. My obnoxiousness is not supposed to be cruel. Usually my obnoxiousness comes from enthusiasm, because I get very excited. The problem is, it still doesn't take away from the fact that I end up just yelling at people. And they don't always appreciate that. Like, So there's this one lady.
This is the problem, though. You're like, let's discuss all of these things, but I can't bring up get in the ring, motherfucker, and how endearing that is.
What?
Like when you would scream, get in the ring, motherfucker.
Oh, well, that was just a Guns N' Roses shit.
I understand that.
I love that song.
But whenever you were doing that, you were enthused.
Oh, yeah. No, listen.
You were obnoxious.
No, but what I'm saying is this.
But it was endearing.
It's so, for instance, someone at the radio station, there is a woman who is a Star Wars fan.
Okay.
I had to shoot a video for her. Okay. So before, while we're setting up the camera and everything like that, I said, I asked her, Teresa is her name. I'll say it. I said, Teresa, you're a big Star Wars fan. I know this. Have you, watched Andor? Yeah. What are you thinking about Andor? She goes, oh, I haven't checked it out. I plan to. I'm just not super excited. Here's my response. What's wrong with you, Teresa?
But just like that?
You got rock for brains?
Oh, jeez.
Huh? You got anything in the old brain area? Or is it all oatmeal north of the eyebrows?
You just started cutting a wrestling
promo? Yeah! Wrestling promos, I sometimes become my life.
Because that was a wrestling promo.
That's pretty much what happens. And she's like, why are you screaming at me? I'm 9 months pregnant.
Oh, my God.
True story.
She'd bite your head off. I wouldn't blame her.
Whatever. The baby should be seeing this, experiencing this. My mom, listen. I was born in 1977, my friend.
Okay.
November.
All right. June 87.
May. And what I'm saying is May. My mom was 4 or 5 months pregnant. She took my older brothers to see Star Wars, but I feel like I got it somehow.
Okay.
I could probably hear it as a little goopy thing.
Yeah, my wife
goopy,
did,
drippy kind of, you know, grimace, a little grimace version of Davy Mac, 4 inches big, you know?
My wife did Tommy the Musical 7 months pregnant.
Did she really?
6 months. Well, she did.
That's loud.
Yeah, I know. Baby loves noise.
Tommy, can you hear me?
She didn't play like a big role, but she was like, you know, an ensemble.
Oh, she was in the play?
Yeah, she was an ensemble.
Oh, if we're going that, I will give you the biggest factoid of all time. I'm not sure if I've ever even said this on any radio show anywhere in the world. Tommy, hold on. I want to sing Tommy a little bit. Oh, the darn microphone. Tommy, can you hear me? Is this annoying when I do this? Tell it to me, Holdo! Is this obnoxious in an endearing way? Now, my mom, when I was literally born in November 1st.
Yes.
In Newport Beach, California. I consider myself a Jersey guy because I've been here since I was a year and a half. But the weird little fact is that I was born in Newport Beach, California. That's not the factoid. The factoid is, in mid-December, they had a community theater play. Some kind of, you know, Bible, you know.
They needed a baby
Christmas.
Jesus.
They chose Darth David. Of all people, right? They chose Darth David as the little Jesus for the play. And my mom actually says this to this time. She goes, you were wonderful. She goes, it was the only time you didn't ruin anything by talking. She's from the Bronx, by the way. That's how she does. She goes, it was amazing. You didn't ruin it by talking. You sat there quiet and still. It was the quietest you ever been. It was the most wonderful you've been in your entire life. To this day.
I'm like, okay. And she said this last Thursday?
That was,
two Thursdays ago.
Well, that was my Sith Master, Beanie. Darth Beanie. Jared.
Yes, David.
That's a little fun, right off the bat. You told me you brought in a little list here. Because we're just going to have a little fun today.
Sure.
Today's going to be a little hodgepodgey. And we're doing that on purpose. We gave you 12, obviously, Andor episodes, Andor intensive. We did the news and stuff in the news for each one of those episodes, but also did the Andors. And we feel like, you know, post-Andor, we just feel like having a little fun today. Might be a long episode, might be very short. We don't know. We'll start getting back into some stuff. I still want us to think about a viewing of Star Wars Episode 4, A New Hope. Maybe during the holiday season at some point. We take a couple weeks off when we do that.
Okay.
I mean, not 2 weeks off. We take 1 week off, but in that time, we do the big Star Wars show.
Okay.
All right. Maybe.
So here's something I wanted to ask you.
Please ask away.
Because I'm watching Rebels now for the first time.
Great show.
So I'm finishing up season 3 now.
Excellent. Yeah. You really make a very fast time. There's only 4 seasons, I believe, yes. Right?
Yeah, okay. And I'll try to watch like an episode or two a day.
Not bad, Jared.
But I've just got to the episode where Hera, Ezra, and Zeb are escorting Mon Mothma to like this big announcement.
Right.
Where she basically starts the Rebel Alliance.
Yeah.
Like, it's a formal declaration of the rebellion.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Season 2.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think they're going to kind of fit some of that continuity? Because at the end of Andor season 1, she's very outspoken in the Senate. But in this episode, she resigns from the Senate. She's branded a traitor because she spoke out against the Emperor. So do you think that we're going to see everything that leads up to that point and then post that?
I think that with Andor, he is being allowed to sort of take Mon Mothma wherever he wants. Tony Gilroy, I should say, Disney is allowing Tony Gilroy to take Mon Mothma to whatever direction he wants Mon Mothma to go in. And he is not constricted with having to follow
any kind of canon.
Specifically the animation. I think that Tony Gilroy is not going to all of a sudden start, you know, pretending like episodes 3 and 4 don't exist or Rogue One doesn't exist. Like, you know, he's going to, he's been following those movies and he understands where those, and this is the Tony Gilroy sweet spot. It's really episodes 3 and 4 and Rogue One. And I think he'll be very true to those movies. Will he play around with a little bit of Mon Mothma and Rebels? I don't know. But at the same time, not that important. I don't think it's that important. With all due respect,
no, I understand
you
that,
probably needed to be watching Rebels 5, 6 years ago.
I get that. I totally
because
get that.
Clone Wars seems to have a little more staying power. Well, not a little bit more. A lot more staying power than Rebels. Having said that, Ahsoka was in Rebels. Ezra, we are going to see, it feels like Sabine. So we are getting Rebels basically live action with Ahsoka. So I get why you would want to watch the show. I also felt like there were excellent episodes in the show.
Yeah,
I thought season 2 was great. The Obi-Wan Kenobi, Darth Maul episode of Rebels is one of my favorite episodes of all time.
But I'm getting there.
Great. And Grand Admiral Thrawn as well.
Yeah,
back was awesome.
So, you know, the guy who does that voice.
That's his brother, right?
That's his brother.
That's
Urso's brother.
Jalen Urso, yeah, the doctor from Rogue One. That's his brother who does that voice.
Does the voice,
That's crazy to me. Talented family.
I know.
What
a menacing character. He's probably one of the best, like, non-Sith bad guys.
Yeah, I mean, he's kind of Blue Tarkin. But he has a little something that Tarkin doesn't have. That interest in art and that kind of interest in culture. Tarkin is straight up military. And while this guy has a military mind, he also has an interest in like culture and things.
But
I think that makes him different.
Not only that, like he's fit. He carries a sidearm with him. You never seen like that episode of the Clone Wars where like you get introduced to Tarkin. He's kind of a little mousy. Kind of, you know, a little, pompous. Whereas, like, Thrawn's like, I'll get my hands dirty if I have to.
Yeah.
I'll do whatever. I might be a high-ranking military guy, but I'm not afraid to fire a gun if I need to.
Right. All right, so what are these 6 lessons? So this is 6 lessons from Lucasfilm about...
It's like 6 takeaways that Lucasfilm could learn from Andor.
6 takeaways Lucasfilm can learn from the success of Andor?
Yes. And this is from The Ringer.
I have not seen this. I will tell you if I, Darth David, agree or disagree with any of these. You may begin, Jedi Jared.
I just want to say this is 6 lessons Lucasfilm can learn from the success of Andor.
You guys speak
into
the mic. You're at their phone.
From The Ringer, written by Miles Suri.
Okay. Miles Suri.
So
if this list sucks, we're going to blame Miles Suri.
So he says,
give normal people some attention. And he says, setting aside all the internet uproar over The Last Jedi, or he's defending The Last Jedi, which, depending on whom you ask, is either the best Star Wars product of the Disney era or the absolute worst, Rian Johnson's film demonstrated how ordinary people were just as capable of extraordinary things as the so-called chosen ones.
Yeah, I love that. I think that's good. It doesn't need to be, you know, 100% of the time. Star Wars is good with a mix. And a mix, you know, being, you know, you could have some Jedis and Siths in some stuff. And then you can have some, you know, regular folks in other stuff. Got no issue with this.
He says, Andor's...
You gotta speak at the mic.
Sorry.
No, here, look. Put the phone like this.
Fine.
And this way you're looking at the phone.
Andor's grounded approach made every corner of its world feel genuinely lived in. Whether it was low-level security officers being berated by his overbearing mother over breakfast, or a rebel leader masquerading as a high-end antiquities dealer in the heart of the Empire's grip.
All right, I'm bored with this already. Go on to the number two. If we agree, we don't need the guy to tell us.
Let the Empire do its thing.
Okay, what does that mean exactly?
For decades, the Galactic Empire was defined by the imposing Darth Vader, the cackling Emperor Palpatine, and the endless stream of stormtroopers notorious for their poor marksmanship. Andor is a fascinating corrective because it actually considers the nuts and bolts of operating an authoritarian regime and just how many people are willing to go along with the Empire's atrocities for the small slice of personal
All right, game. Well, listen. Okay, I'll stop you there. There is some truth to the Empire looks better now. Like, more successful, more dangerous, higher quality. But I don't think that's a mistake either. I think that by the time we saw the Empire in episodes, especially like 5 and 6, that they're off the rails a little bit. That Palpatine, you know, the quality control for the Empire isn't there. So we're seeing them right here in Andor at their absolute peak of their powers. They are a tremendous running machine right now. And I don't think they're as smooth, you know, as well running in episode 6 and 7.
Well, you got to think that,
6 and 7, 5 and 6, five, sorry.
So Tarkin was on the Death Star when it exploded. Is that that thing? So Tarkin's no longer around. So it just goes...
First Death Star, right.
So the destruction of the Death Star is a huge kick in the groin. And then the death of the guy who was running the actual administration, the day-to-day operation, is dead now too. So
yes.
That's a huge blow to the Empire. So... Yeah, no, I agree at this point.
But listen, Empire is good. It's always good. Oh, you have to read this next one. I'll be right back. Yaddle Chattle fans, Darth David will return.
You ready?
Yes.
Okay. Embrace moral gray areas. When Andor is introduced in Rogue One, he kills an informant without a moment's hesitation. It's a shocking incident. Not least of all because it's already established that Andor is fighting for the good guys. But if Rogue One and Andor have taught Star Wars anything, it's that moral compromises are sometimes necessary to enact meaningful change in the galaxy.
Okay. All right, so what was the main gist of the top line?
Embrace moral gray areas.
Moral gray areas.
Like Han shooting first.
Again, you know, what's the guy's name who did this list? Sweeney Murdy?
No, Miles Suri.
Miles Suri. Miles, it just feels like he likes Andor. And basically he just wants like season 2.
Yeah.
I mean, everything he's saying is a good thing that Andor did. I got no issues with Miles saying, I enjoyed this about Andor. None whatsoever. I think he's raising good things that we like about Andor. But we don't need to see it on every show. The whole gray area thing was sort of explored in Episode 8. In Episode 8, the last time I checked, is a very polarizing film. Right? I mean, even explored in Episode 9. With Rey being a Palpatine and being raised a Sith. Gray area can work on a spy show like Andor. But if it's not a spy show, You don't always need as much gray area. You know, you in wrestling, if there's too much gray area and you have too many babyface versus babyface, heel versus heel matches, you do lose the audience.
I understand that, but to back what he's saying, if you recall Tales from the Jedi, the Count Dooku arc was very much about moral ambiguity and that gray area.
Yeah, that's right. So, that's right.
So, and it was the more popular of the story arcs.
Yes, it was. No, that's good. That's good. Tales from the Jedi was had some really good episodes in it. Those Dooku episodes were great, and I do want more. How come they only gave us 6?
I don't know. I think that's all he really worked on, and plus he was probably working on the Bad Batch too.
All right.
And plus all the live action.
It's a small amount of episodes. For that show, when the episodes themselves were 16, 17 minutes.
You could either look at it as a television series, or you can kind of look at it as like a mini, like a movie.
No, I looked at it as a special, but I want more. Go ahead.
He goes, fan service should be a last resort.
Again, if it's lame and obvious, you know, a fan service is annoying. When it's cool and done in an organic way, it's awesome. Sometimes Star Wars, something might happen with a character, and he needs the help from another character. And sometimes that other character is good when they're brand spanking new. And then sometimes it's like, hold on, this other character has all of the qualities of such and such from the original trilogy, prequel trilogy. Why don't we just grab that character, and then it's fun for the fans, because now that guy is, or girl is back. That's what I'm saying.
Well, we Easter saw that with Saw Gerrera. Saw Gerrera was on the Clone Wars as a kid. We see him as an older man in Rogue One. We see him again in Rebels as like a young, like...
Yeah, I mean, that's a stupid comment fact. Limit, or what is it? No fan service?
He says...
Sweeney Murdy said what?
He said fan service should be a last resort.
Okay, let me explain something to you. Grogu was fan service, bro. No one in the world complained. But we've seen Yodas before. This was not a new character.
It was a baby.
And it was a baby version of Yoda. And that's fan service. Because you're bringing back something that the fans knew, that the fans could relate to, that the fans could connect with, that would resonate with the fans.
But you turned it on their head.
You just made him into a Muppet baby. No one's complaining. Grogu's right there. I love Grogu. Like everyone else. I love Grogu. That's fan service. You might not recognize it, but I do. There's tons of fan service. What are you talking about? It's got to be organic. Can't be forced. You can't crowbar in the fan service. But if there's a natural spot for a character we've seen before, a planet we've seen before, so on and so forth, why not? Sometimes the annoying thing about Star Wars is the new stuff when the old stuff was just fine. For instance, why Jakku? At the end of the day, why don't we just have Rey on Tatooine? It was the same planet and you goddamn know it. Like, why? Just call it Tatooine. We don't need it being called Jakku. You see what I'm saying? Like, some of that stuff don't need to happen. If you create something that's exactly like something that exists already in Star Wars, just make it the other thing. And then it's Easter eggy or fan service, but it's not really fan service. It's saying, hey, we need a desert planet. We might as well use Tatooine and not come up with something called Jakku.
Well, I can see where he's coming from in a certain sense, because Episode 7 basically was a repeat of Episode 4.
Intentionally to get the kids into Star Wars. A new generation of children to Star Wars, and it worked hook, line, and sinker, since my son, Sith Stanley, worships the sequel trilogy.
Really?
Episode 8's his favorite Star Wars film of all time.
Okay.
And he's heard Yaddle Chattle episodes. He's heard his father, Darth David, saying he likes Episode 8. And I do! Just don't like him killing off Luke Skywalker. I didn't have fanboy tears either. I just had disappointment. Like, you don't kill off a main character in the second act of a play.
That don't happen. It's bad storytelling.
Well, he goes...
Nevertheless. All right, and what's his last point? That was 5 points, right?
Actually, clone Tony Gilroy, question mark.
Clone Tony Gilroy?
Yes.
Oh, so he made it silly. He made it silly at the end.
Well, I mean, it's...
You're having a little fun, huh? I was going to take your list seriously, brother, until you did that clone Tony Gilroy thing.
I mean, he's not wrong. I mean, if you had two...
Minus 200 points for Sweeney Murdy and his shitty goddamn article.
Miles Surrey.
Whatever. Get him out of here. Until that last entry, I was playing ball.
What's wrong with Tony...
I love Tony Gilroy. We're not going to clone Tony Gilroy. We're not going to be cloning people.
Well, you have his brother, so that's close enough.
Now, I've got some news for you.
Okay.
They are saying that they are shooting, Dave Filoni's shooting live-action series Ahsoka right now as we speak. Early buzz is that she might be going to Dagobah.
Oh.
Now, do you think, that means we're going to be... do we know when Ahsoka takes place? I'm assuming it takes place during Mando, right? Same time?
I think, well...
5-6 years after Return of the Jedi?
Yeah, because they've casted an older Ezra Bridger. So it would make sense that...
No Yoda, though. But I guess his spirit, the Force Ghost, could be there.
So his Force Ghost could be there. So we might get to see a new appearance from Frank Oz. Two, the whole point of Yoda going to Dagobah was because it's like a Force-ambiguous planet.
Can you call it Dagobah? Because the way you said it made it sound offensive to Italians.
What'd I say?
I ain't repeating it.
Dagobah?
You didn't say it like that. You said I call it Dagobah.
Dagobah?
Mm-hmm.
What'd I say?
You said Dago. Bah.
I said Dagobah.
You know, and that's offensive. that was Jedi Jared.
No, I said...
Offending Italians, by the way. Not Darth David.
I said Dagobah.
Dago?
Dagobah.
Bah is what you said.
Dagobah.
And the first two syllables are offensive. That's an offensive a term. Our fine Italian-American friends.
Is that like calling them Fredo or something like that?
You've never heard the term Dago?
Yeah, of course I have.
Well, that's what you just said.
I thought I said...
Everyone else calls it Dagobah.
I thought I said Dagobah. Isn't that how Luke says that?
You focused on the Dago is my point.
No.
You sat there and let those first two syllables
I said Dagobah.
People are going to rewind now. Dago. And they're going to check the tape. I encourage you, Yaddleheads, go back and check the tape then, for Christ's sakes. Did he emphasize the first two syllables when he said Dagobah? I'm not crazy.
Dagobah. That's right.
Let's move on.
Okay, fine. It's supposed to be an ambiguous, like a Force-ambiguous planet. That's why the Emperor never found him.
Dagobah?
Yeah.
I thought, I wouldn't say, Force-ambiguous is a bad term.
Well...
Force rich. It's super, super, super,
it's super
duper force
rich, but
strong
it's,
with the force.
It's force neutral.
Well, what I'm saying though, if the force is that force don't work the way you think it does.
Yeah, it does.
No, it doesn't. There's not two separate forces. There's one force.
No, there is one force.
Right. So it's strong with the force. It's about how you utilize the force and are one with it. Do you utilize the force? Do you embrace purity and innocence and decency on the light side? Or is it all about selfishness and your own personal gain on the dark side? But it's still the same force.
Yeah, but I think the whole thing was that it was... because if that was the case, then it would have amplified Yoda's force.
No! He was testing Luke!
They were hiding. He was in hiding from the Empire. He was in hiding from Vader and Palpatine.
No, I know, but what are you saying? You think that the whole planet would be what?
It's like masking Yoda.
Yes! That's why it's strong with the Force, not light or dark. It's just Force.
Well, but there are planets, though. Like, there are Sith planets that are, Sith temples. You won't find a Sith temple and a Jedi temple on the same planet, correct?
I haven't seen one, but I mean, Coruscant, you had the Jedi Temple, and obviously there's not going to be a Sith Temple there. I mean, Palpatine has chambers there, but that wasn't a proper Sith temple.
That was like more of a Jedi headquarters as opposed to like where you would see where all the Jedis go get their. They never get their kyber crystal at the Jedi temple on Coruscant.
Well, okay, but they called it the Jedi temple, dude. They didn't call it the Jedi headquarters. I can only they're saying in the goddamn movie.
I understand that, but I feel like there are certain planets that are lean a certain way, and Dagobah, yeah. If you think about it.
So wait a second. You think there are evil planets and good planets?
No, I think that, but if you recall when that episode of Clone Wars where they go to that,
The Mortis trilogy.
Mortis trilogy. When they go to Mortis, they're like, this person embodies everything that's good, and this person embodies everything that's evil, and that the father was supposed to be the halfway point. So that's what Dagobah is. It's the halfway point as a planet.
I mean, sort of. I just think that there are planets that have more force. I don't think there are good planets and bad planets.
I'm not
saying
that there's good planets.
In the same way that a planet might have more oxygen. A planet might have, you know, a larger ozone layer. I think it's almost like a physical thing. You know, some planets might just, you know, be strong with the force. It's kind of like what they say about on planet Earth. Which is there are certain spots on planet Earth where there's lots of, you know, like energy shit. Like Bermuda Triangle.
But where?
And the dead zone in, Mexico and the Stonehenge and shit like that. There are different places on our planet that have some kind of weird, stronger with energy. Look, I'm not going to try and turn this into Davy Max Area 51. I'm just trying to tell you that scientists would say that there are spots, energy spots on our planet. And I think it's the same thing on a galactic level.
There are energy planets, but I feel like there are some energy planets that might amplify the force.
I think it's if Yoda's the guy there, then he's probably making Dagobah chill. I think if Vader lived on Dagobah, then yes, it would feel evil. If Yoda lives on Dagobah, it feels probably a little bit lighter. It's because, though, the planet is filled with the Force. The planet can't decide whether to be good or bad.
Well,
it's a planet. In fact, the more I think about it, that's a stupid thing to say. Minus 15 points for you. Plus 2 points for me. Planets can't be good or evil.
Sure they can.
So what's Mars? Huh? Is Mars a scumbag?
Yeah.
And Jupiter's a nice guy?
No.
And Saturn sucks?
Saturn's good.
What about Pluto? Good or bad?
It's not a planet.
Neptune? Good or bad?
Good.
Venus? Good or bad?
Good.
Mercury? Good or bad?
Bad.
Very interesting. And what was the rationale for all of those answers? Yeah, nothing. There was none. Next!
Yeah, but that's not... we don't live in a force-rich galaxy, unfortunately.
Actually, this apartment is extremely strong with the force.
Okay.
Watch this. Ready? Watch this. Ready? Watch my right hand. I'm going to make this lightsaber float up into my hand. Ready? Watch this. Okay, ready?
I command my lightsaber to rise! Rise to my hand! Rise! Look at this! Rise, I say! Rise, lightsaber! And kill Jared!
All right, that come on, round of applause for that. That was like a cinema trick. That was worth it, YouTube. YouTube fans, thanks for watching. That was worth it. Podcast fans, you missed the shittiest goddamn special effect in human history. Jared Mando, season 3, they say March 1st.
So when is Ahsoka coming out? Ahsoka was supposed to come out before?
Oh, really? I thought Mando was out first.
I guess.
I thought it was Mando, Ahsoka, Acolyte.
Oh.
But I don't know.
Oh.
Well, predictions for Mando 3. Mando versus Bo-Katan?
I think that might be a case. I've heard that Giovanni Esposito is supposed to be back too.
That guy is unbelievable.
He's a great actor.
Yeah. Oh, he's been great his whole entire career.
I know.
Usual Suspects, and he was in this great movie, Smoke, that I love. Oh, Breaking Bad. I mean, Do the Right Thing by Spike Lee. I mean, he was in that. He was in a notable character, you know, with walking around, yelling at people, getting into trouble.
Giancarlo Esposito, sorry.
Giancarlo Esposito. Yeah, I that name didn't sound right.
Giancarlo, sorry.
It was like you were thinking of Giovanni Ribisi, and I was like, come on, man. Hey, listen. My prediction is Mando is, we're going to have to see somebody die this year, I think. Somebody important. Not Grogu.
No.
But Carl Weathers might go. I could see Carl getting killed.
I could see, was it Timothy Omniplant dying?
Yeah.
Because he had a close call against Cad Bane.
Yeah. The only thing I wonder with Timothy Oliphant is, are they saving him for Book of Boba Fett Season 2? Since that was the season finale scene after the credits. Remember he was in the back of the tank? Felt like if they make a Season 2, he's going to be out there and, you know, doing something.
We might see the revival of some of the other famous Mandalorians that we've seen in the cartoons, too.
Like what? Like who?
I don't know if they're all still alive.
Because a lot of them died. The one that Jon Favreau played got beheaded by Darth Maul. Yeah.
But what about the guy that befriends the Rebels and that he stays on the planet with Sabine? I forgot his fucking name. And then there's the other guy who was like, he was a part of the Empire. Like, he had sold out.
Okay. All right.
So, I'm like, literally completely forgot their names. But
I know. Apparently you did. Don't ask me to name them.
I think because it's a Filoni thing, we're going to see the Jedi be trained as a Mandalorian, because the whole point of the Darksaber was that it was a Mandalorian that got trained to be a Jedi. So now we're seeing we're seeing something familiar be inversed.
So you think Mando's going to be training Grogu?
To become a Mandalorian, yeah.
I like that, because that gives us a little reversal Yoda thing too. You know, that gives us, we always see the Yoda creatures training. And I know we saw Grogu train under Luke, but I think if they took their time and really had a few episodes of Mando helping, yeah, I could dig that. My only request for Mando and some of these Filoni Favreau things is, we did get spoiled with 12 episodes of Andor, and even if they don't do 12, I really hope they don't give us like the 6 or 7 episodes anymore. It's just too short for me. Mando, I would like to give us 10 episodes.
Were Andor episodes like...
They were almost an hour, every single one. One or two of them were like around the 38, 39 minute mark, but almost everyone else was like 55 minutes. So I honestly, you know, think it's possible.
It might have to do with budget.
Okay. Well, Andor showed that... At least quality-wise, you know, I don't know how much money they put into Andor, but it looked like they put in more to Andor than Mando.
It seemed like they put, well, I think with Mando.
They said $10 million per episode.
Was how much the
Mandalorian. So, I mean, if that's the case, to me, Andor looked above that.
Well, it was mostly practical.
But also the shots, the cinematic shots looked cinematic, where you can go into a movie theater and see some of those cinematic shots from Andor, and Mando looks like a TV show. Again, not criticizing it. I love The Mandalorian. It just looks like a cool TV show, but a TV show.
I think that has more to do with
the volume than anything.
Well, that and the special effects.
It's the same fucking thing. That's what the volume is for. It's for the special effects.
Okay.
Have you watched the Star Wars, all of the Star Wars galleries? All of the behind-the-scenes specials that you're supposed to be watching?
I feel like I have.
All of them?
Yeah.
Okay. Hopefully they put out everything. I can't wait for the Andor one. And I do think sometimes they take too long to put out the documentary. Yeah. We shouldn't have to wait 3 months for the Andor thing. Give us the Andor thing this month in December.
I think they just don't want to spoil it. Like, some people might watch the behind-the-scenes stuff before they watch the series.
Come on. Come on. No one's going to get spoiled. They're not going to go and watch Andor behind the scenes if they haven't seen the show. They're either not going to have enough. If they don't have enough interest to watch the show itself, then they're not going to have interest to watch the doc. The making of. So let's go. Let's go. That would be a nice holiday present.
I don't know
from Disney, is if you gave us the Andor behind the scenes, the Star Wars gallery for Andor this December. Thank you.
Okay. I don't.
I'm talking to you, Iger.
I don't know.
Now that you're back in the game, Bob. Something about Acolyte.
Oh yeah. So the Acolyte is supposed to be like. So since it's taking place during the High Republic 100 years before episode one, it's Sith-centric. It's supposed to be showing the rise of the Sith.
I love it. Now, how long?
100 years.
Before?
Episode one. So Yoda's like.
100 years before episode one. And this is the rise of the Sith?
Like the. Well, you gotta understand, in the galaxy.
Because I feel like the Sith have been around for thousands and thousands of years.
Well, no,
but
like,
sure what
it's like an ebb and flow. So there have been points where the Jedi, like in the original trilogy, were almost non-existent. Maybe there were a handful of Jedis or Jedi adjacents during that whole period.
I see.
There have been times where, like, there were multiple, like, before the rule of
Who's Palpatine's guy again?
Plagueis?
Darth Plagueis. We gotta be seeing him, right?
I think so.
It's about it. Come on.
I think we might see a younger Palpatine.
Yeah, I mean, 100 years?
I don't know. I'm not 100.
Baby Palps? Like a little baby Grogu? I could see Palpatine, like, dressed like Angus Young. With the little, you know, schoolboy shirts and shorts.
I don't know as much about a lot of the pre... Like, all the...
About Star Wars. You don't know as much about Star Wars in general. Yeah. Now you're coughing.
Yeah, I guess.
Listen. That's all.
No, let me just finish my thought before I... I'm going to cough and have a coughing fit.
Please. Finish your point. Finish your point, coffee.
I'm not sure if this is before the rule of two. But here's the other thing, though, is that all of this other extra Lucas extended stuff, like... Rebels and Obi-Wan Kenobi has shown that there are, like, the Inquisitors. They're not technically Sith Lords,
no.
But they're...
Dark side users.
They're dark side users. You know, we've seen, you know, in a lot of the extended stuff, like, what is it? The Force Unleashed. He wasn't... Vader's apprentice technically wasn't...
So what's your point?
I'm saying is that it'll be interesting to see more Sith.
So are you saying that Palpatine created the Sith rule of
no,
two?
No. There's a,
okay, I thought that's what you were saying.
No, it's something.
That actually wouldn't be a bad idea, though. If he was, since he's the one who killed Plagueis,
I think
and recognized instantly, look, there's going to be a sneaky son of a bitch coming up right behind me, so I'll keep this rule of two thing going. At least I can always keep tabs on one guy.
It's something with a B. Begins with a B.
All right.
He was the original Sith Lord that said, we're not going to have an order. It's a rule of two.
Jared, new art from Trev, a.k.a. Contrarian. And that will be, that's on the
we'll put on the thumbnail
right now, or as we speak. We didn't put all those Ron and Fez ones up, those ones where he's making fun of you, but we showed them on our other show, Davey Bag Sports Program.
So you can go back and watch that.
Yeah, you can watch that. And, but this is new art from, Trev, Contrarian, and we thank him very much. Just fantastic stuff, right?
Oh yeah, he's doing a great job.
Also, for the first time ever, we're seeing a Palpatine action figure that had no hood. The Star Wars nerds are all excited. It's always funny to see Palpatine's hair. Because you do feel like the hood is just, you know, it's such a part of the gimmick.
Yes.
That
makes him look more menacing.
But when he took the hood off, he still has the scary zombie melted face.
But he looks like a...
But he's got the white comb-backed hair.
Oh, he has hair.
He still has hair.
Oh, they didn't make him look Pajorian.
No, it has hair.
Oh.
It's
a little disappointing.
Yeah, I thought, yeah. Yeah, you'd figure if the face almost got it melted off due to the, you know, Mace Windu ricochet, you'd figure the hair would have come off.
Yeah.
I agree.
Plus, he looks, like, more menacing with no hair.
Yeah, when I was, I almost felt like he looked odd.
With hair?
With hair, even in the prequels. Even though I knew that he's playing a politician and this and that. He's got to have hair and stuff like that. I just felt like, you know, always go with the hood. Or a hat. Maybe a nice little hat. Okay. Star Wars cage match.
Oh.
What?
Did you want to do the other thing? You wanted to do a best.
No, I'm not doing that today because actually I forgot the one thing that I did want to do.
What did we want to do?
I gave you a challenge before the show.
Oh, okay. We're going to actually do that.
And we are going to actually do that. Let me get some music for you.
Okay.
I challenged Jared because I'm always the one who's doing voices around here. So I challenged Jared 3 Star Wars impressions for this program.
Okay. I can do it.
And you have accepted this challenge?
I have. I have got 2 out of the 3. I'm trying to figure out the 3rd one now.
All right, let me prepare some music for you.
Oh, I can do it. I can do that.
All right, hold on. Let me get some music for you. Don't be such a piece of shit.
I'm not being a piece of
shit. Okay, good. All right. Give you a little music bed. Okay. So that when these impressions all inevitably fail miserably, you know, at least you got a little music bed. You can hide your shitty impressions that everyone's going to mock you for the rest of your life.
That's fine.
Because when you don't have the music bed and you fail, it's really brutal.
I know. I'm not.
I've been there.
I know. I'm not you or Jay Dyer, so.
All right. Go ahead. And nice and loud with these impressions.
Chaka wuka taka solo. Ho ho ho.
I mean, that's Jabba?
Yes.
Do it again, please.
Chaka wuka taki wake o solo. Ho ho ho.
I like the fact that you seem to have gotten the Huttese down properly, and you seem to have it all word for word. As far as Jabba goes, what, Jabba get his testicles ripped off before the impression?
Ho, ho, ho.
That's what I'm... You put the bass in it, bro.
Sorry.
And by the way, that last impression could have also been Santa with the ho, ho, ho.
That would have been ho, ho, but a little more jollier.
But if you're Jabba, you gotta have the Andre the Giant deep voice, okay? Do it now, do it properly. Deep voice.
Chaka hunda ka koke, tuki wukia, solo.
Better.
Ho, 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 ho.
All right, half a point. Number 2, impression number 2.
Wah, 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 wah.
What the fuck, man? You always suck at this. Because you choose obscure bullshit.
Oh, come on.
That's only amusing to you.
My daughter loves Chopper. She loves Chopper.
You just did a Chopper impression?
Yeah. He goes, wah, 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 wah.
Everyone hates you. This, from now on, the impression needs to be done from a movie or a TV, live action. Sorry, Chopper doesn't count. Give us a new impression number 2. We're not doing that.
All right, fine.
You said you had a 3rd one.
No, I do. Judge me by my size, do you?
All right, you went with Yoda.
My daughter loves it, so.
You went with... So, you just sit at home doing really awful Star Wars impressions for little Leia, newborn baby?
We have a ritual at night where if I'm the one putting her to bed, I change her to Yoda's theme. And then she'll get, like, super fussy as, like, we have to put lotion and we have to do, like, the nightly ritual of getting her in her little sweepy gown.
I mean, Yoda's theme is great.
But if she gets really super upset, she's actually gotten much better, I would play Yoda's monologue from Empire, where he goes into the Force.
And I love it.
She's just she loves Yoda. She loves, my daughter loves Star Wars.
What is not to love about Yoda?
I mean,
Yoda rule. Yeah, I love, look, he's right behind us.
Because we were watching,
get him a little bit better here. Here you go, look at that, right there.
When we would watch
beautiful jigsaw puzzle.
When we would watch the Clone Wars together,
yes, sir.
She would like, babble, like she'd scream and yell, but when Yoda came on,
nothing.
Nothing. She loved.
Intensity, focus.
On Yoda.
Good. She's a possible Jedi. Possible Sith as well. Now give us a real impression number three. Because Chopper, the Yaddleheads were going to kill you for that one.
What's wrong with
Chopper? I'm trying to keep the heat off of you. The Yaddleheads were going to destroy you. Let's go. Give us something real. Live action. Movie or TV show. Doesn't matter, but it's got to be live action.
These aren't the droids you're looking for.
Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Yes.
Okay. You just chose, like, the biggest fucking lines. Why not just do the goddamn Vader at this point? I'm your father. Why not just do that? You chose the huge, massive lines.
Well, that's the point, no?
Well, I guess. It's amazing.
Should have done TDD.
I can't do it anymore.
What's TDD?
It's, was it the Jawas?
Oh, you're titty!
He goes,
Utady!
Utady!
Utady, I think it is. Alright.
Titty!
Overall, I'm gonna give you a solid C minus.
Nice.
It actually wasn't the worst shit you could have done. It wasn't good either.
I can't do impressions like I used to.
No.
No, I can't.
You can't.
I used to be really good at
that. By the way, you used to not be able to do them as well. I've known you for like 15 years.
Yeah, you never
done one single good impression in the entire time I've known you.
Well, you never let me not. You usually are the one doing the impressions.
Now listen, it's a Star Wars
cage
match that you are responsible for.
Oh, so I had to do that too.
You had to bring two goddamn pieces of show prep today. Let's go. Can it what?
No, it's... Oh, forget it. I've got it.
Okay,
I've got it.
He's ready to go. He's got it. Okay. Star Wars cage match. Here he goes. He's got it.
Star Wars cage
match. So you come up with these off the top of your head. You are responsible for this bit every single week.
I don't think about it until 57 minutes in.
All you have to do is go through a fucking Star Wars book and just randomly come up with two characters. And you can't even do that.
Okay.
You know why Yaddleheads hate you? Go ahead.
All right. Fine, David. Fine. Because I used to do babyface versus babyface. You hate babyface versus babyface.
I'm a wrestling guy. I just told you. Too many babyface versus babyface heel versus heel matches loses the audience. Loses me. Let's go. Good versus evil. Let's go.
Good versus evil. Okay.
So that's what it's all about.
Fine. Okay. Director Krennic.
I love him. Go ahead. I love Director Krennic.
Versus Admiral Holdo.
Which one's Admiral Holdo?
Isn't that Lord Dern's character?
It's Holdo.
Holdo.
Holdo. Holdo. Holdo.
They all pronounce it Holdo.
They don't say Holdo. It's Holdo.
They said Holdo.
I gotta go back and look. Krennic will fucking throttle that lady.
She's a fucking admiral, and he's a director.
The only thing...
He's a project manager.
Her only move was to commit suicide. Her only move was to kill herself.
Harry Carey.
Whereas, like, other people... Yeah, well, no, Harry Carey, right? Harry Carey's the fucking Cubs announcer.
Oh, same shit.
Her Super only crew. Goddamn, you know, that was it. To me, that ain't the most, like, strategic... wise, intelligent maneuver. You know, any fucking stupid asshole could just drive their car or something into someone else. That's all she did, only with a starship level. No way. Krennic, he will decimate this Admiral Holdo easily.
He is a guy who's very similar to Cyril, except he actually will kill people. However... He's a project manager. That's all he is.
Oh, you didn't see him getting rolling up the sleeves every single time there was a ruckus
because
and
he's
kept out there
screwing up.
Yeah, but he
because he's a shitty project manager.
Right, but he will get his hands dirty. He's got no issues slapping people around and having them killed on the platform.
I understand that, but I mean, if he was a more effective manager, then he wouldn't have to continue with
this. This ain't about managing. This ain't about managing.
I understand
that. This is a fight to the death. We put these two characters.
He's incompetent.
We put these characters in a goddamn cage and let him claw each other's eyes out.
I think Lord Dern will win.
Krennic is coming out alive.
Lord Dern.
Plus 6 points for me, minus two for you. That'll do it. We're in the holiday season. I love Star Wars during holiday time. That's another thing. Did I tell you that when every single Christmas, Davey Mack was responsible for choosing the Star Wars movie? We'd watch around 4 or 5 o'clock after everyone had eaten the presents, this, that. We would go down to the basement, and it was always me. And I have to tell you, Empire Strikes Back won most of the years because of the snow.
I
look at it as a Christmas movie because of the snow.
I've seen... I saw both episode 8 and 9 with my nephew. Like, every year we go to the Smoky... Or every year my in-laws go to the Smoky Mountains in Pigeon Forge in Gatlinburg. And I saw both those movies with my nephew during that season, like that week between Christmas and New Year's.
That's cool.
Yeah, for $5.
Not bad.
$5. There's a movie theater there. It's $5.
Sometimes I've gone to Jedi. And then sometimes I, for the Christmas movie. Sometimes episode 4. It's always nice. But ultimately, I feel like I do a lot of Empire on Christmas. Like I said.
Because of the snow.
Do the snow.
I get it.
Well, that'll do it.
Okay. So.
We're back next week.
We'll be back next week.
We're probably going to take a week off in December.
Yes. When I'm away.
At some point. Oh, when he's away?
When I'm away.
Okay. When he's away. When I'm apparently. Away. It's nice that he told his co-host.
I told you that.
About this going away thing. I didn't hear
I did.
That.
I did.
Going
I told
away.
You.
You're getting frozen in carbonite? Is that what's happening?
Can I do the plugs, please? Can I do the plugs, please? Thank you. Okay. You can like and follow Eastside Dave on all social media platforms at Eastside Dave. You can check us out on eastsidedavecountry.com. Wherever you get your podcasts.
Hurry up.
Watcher/Yaddle Chattle feed.
Come on, you're going to ruin the beautiful ending.
YouTube.
Hey, he's Jedi Jared.
Eastside
I'm Darth David. Good night, everybody.